Chapa, and I'm a second year economics student. Before I begin my presentation, I'd like to tell you a story from my childhood. One of my favorite childhood memories was when I was a kid, probably 5 or 6 years old, and I remember watching a meteor shower with my mom. And it was one of my favorite memories because it looked so pretty, like it was raining stars. This is what it looked like, but not like this wonderful, but something like that. And I really liked that memory, and a few years back I was talking to my mom, and I said to her, "Mom, do you remember when we watched the meteor shower?" And my mom said, "What meteor shower?" Apparently, my brain had created a memory of something that I had never seen before. And I know what you're thinking right now, I'm probably crazy, but I'm not. I did some research, and I'm perfectly sane. And this is a condition that the brain does unconsciously, so we don't even notice when that happens. Well, that brings me to the topic of my presentation today. Today I'd like to talk about two main reasons why we form false memories. I have divided this presentation in two parts. The first part is source confusion, and the second part is gap filling. Without further ado, I'd like to begin with the first part. Source confusion. Now, you probably do not understand what this means because it's a psychological term, and I'll explain it to you. Well, I'll explain it with a simple analogy. Do you remember when you're like reading a good book and there's so many details and very descriptive, and you feel like you're inside the book? Well, source confusion is something like that. It's experiencing something versus hearing or seeing it. And I'd like to give you two examples about this so it can be a little bit clearer. Well, the first one is a blitz bombing in London, and I got this from an article from Sax in 2013. Well, this is how it goes. Sax was alive in the Second World War, and he was in London. And there were two big bombs in London, and he was talking to his brother about this. Like, "Do you remember the bombs that happened in Sax?" And the brother said, "Well, I remember the first one, but I don't remember the second one because none of us were there when that happened." And Sax, just like me, had created a false memory of a bombing that he hadn't seen. So why had he created this memory? Well, the newspapers had written so much about it that it felt like he was actually there. And he was so sure that he had actually seen it. So that's why he had created a false memory. And the second example is from Ward in his article 2016. And this is the Lost in the Mall experiment. Well, they got a guy who was about 30 years old, and they asked him questions about his life. And they mentioned, "Well, do you remember when you got lost in the mall?" And he looked at them and said, "I have never been lost in the mall." So they were just making this up. He hadn't actually been lost in the mall, but they were trying to tell him, they were like, "Well, don't you remember you were in the mall and you were alone and you lost?" And after 30 minutes, he started believing that he had actually been lost in the mall. Isn't that crazy? I mean, our brain is awesome, but, well, pretty dumb at the same time. This guy, he was in 30 years of life, and he still like tried to remember. He was explaining to them how he got lost in the mall when he actually hadn't been lost in the mall. This is the first part of my presentation. I'd like to move on to the second part, which is gap filling. This is exactly what the title suggests. You just fill the gaps of the things you don't remember. It's just like completing a puzzle. You know, when you're trying to find the pieces, or when you don't remember something, but you just, well, assume what might have happened. I'd like to give you an example of this. Suppose that you are asked to observe what students do when the minute they enter the exam room. Now, what usually happens is as follows. They enter the exam room, and then they start complaining about the exams and how much they had to study about it. And then they start the exam, eventually. Now, suppose that you don't actually see the students complaining about the exam. Well, you can just imagine and ask yourself, but what do the students normally do? And so you'd be just going to say, well, they complain probably. Now, this is a false memory because you hadn't actually seen that thing, so maybe you are making it up. Maybe they didn't complain, maybe they were looking at their notes. This is one way of creating false memory. And the second part is using stereotypes. I believe everyone knows what stereotypes is, but just in case, I'll just explain it so you're thinking about the same thing. A stereotype is an oversimplified or general image or idea about a thing or a person. For example, I hope there are no mechanical engineering students in here, but when I ask you what does a mechanical engineering student look like, you probably say, well, they probably have a long beard and probably they wear glasses. This is a stereotype because it doesn't mean that all mechanical engineering students have long beards and wear glasses. And I'd like to talk about an experiment actually from Boyer in 2016. It was in his article, and I suggest you all read it because it was really cool. And it's about a librarian. They take a few people and they tell them that they are going to watch a video about a librarian, and they were going to ask questions about it. And they watch the video and they start asking questions like, what did the librarian look like? And almost everyone said that librarian had glasses and she liked classical music. Now, this was nothing about it in this video. She didn't wear glasses nor did she listen to classical music. I mean, there was no information about it. But people had stereotypes because she's a librarian. She probably likes to read books, so she probably wears glasses. And because she likes to listen to calm music while reading, well, she probably doesn't like rock, she likes classical music. So people use stereotypes of trying to remember something that they hadn't actually seen. They have formed false memories. Well, I believe this brings me to the end of my presentation today, but before I finish, I'll just ask you something. When your friends are telling you an extraordinary story or something that you don't believe they actually experienced, please do not judge them immediately. Maybe it's not their fault, maybe their brain had created false memories, and now you know why can that happen. It can happen because of source confusion and gap filling. Thank you for your attention. If there are any questions, I'd be happy to take them now. Okay then, here's my reference list. You can check these articles for yourself. Thank you.